There are hundreds, possibly thousands of videos on YouTube talking about the SIG Spear, the Army's new next generation weapon system, chambered in 277 Fury or 68x51. The thing that separates this video from the majority of them is we have actually shot it a lot. So far in this series, we've looked at the ballistic capabilities of 277 Fury and its counterpart 68x51, and they are both extremely impressive out of only a 13-inch barrel. Then we took a look at the effectiveness of these new rounds against level 4 body armor in the second video. In this video, we're going to look at the machine delivering those rounds, the SIG Spear or the Army's XM7, which was previously known as the XM5 or M5. If you haven't seen the first two videos in the series, I highly recommend you go back and check them out. This rifle belongs to Illumined Arms, and none of this would be possible without their help. They've got a lot of amazing things in the works. This will definitely be a company you will be hearing a lot more from in the very near future. Go give them a follow on social media so you can stay up to date on everything Illumined Arms has coming down the pipe. What we could be witnessing here is a paradigm shift. A paradigm shift is a fundamental change in understanding assumptions. Basically, a change so big, not only does it change your understanding of concepts, but also how you understand those concepts. It's change at a massive level, and that is what this rifle could represent. For those that don't know, recently the Army held trials for its next generation weapon system to find a replacement for the M4. The Army wanted to provide the US warfighters with more power and be effective at greater distances while maintaining a package that was still compact enough to use as a close quarters weapon. They were looking for something that could overcome body armor and be more effective at longer ranges while gaining reliability and accuracy. The SIG MCX Spear in 277 Fury or 68x51 was chosen to be the Army's next generation weapon system. Now don't think that next year you will see all M4s vanish from the hands of our troops and all of them be carrying the new Spear. It will take years to roll them out, and we may see small changes or improvements to this rifle over those years. But in general, this will be the way the Army has decided to go. I highly urge you to go back and see the first video in the series where we look at 277 Fury and its capabilities. I'm not going to dwell on that here because this video we're pretty much going to look at just the firearm that delivers that round, but this rifle does shoot an extremely potent round, and that round's effectiveness out of only a 13-inch barrel is extremely impressive. Since this is touted as both being a long-range weapon and a close-quarters weapon, we did our very best to test it in a wide array of situations to assess this rifle's ability to be the ultimate all-around solution for any fighting scenario. Let's walk through the features of the rifle, and I'll give you my impressions as we go through them. If we start at the tip of the rifle, you have the SIG clutch flash hider. This thing is a very good method of attaching a silencer, but with changing dynamics of YouTube, I'll have to do a separate video on the silencers used in this video and the clutch attachment method for Patreon and Utreon subscribers. There's a two-position gas regulator for the piston, one for normal use and one for adverse conditions if the gun were to become severely dirty. We shot the whole time on the normal setting. We ran a ton of rounds through the Spear while we had the chance to review it, and 99% of that was suppressed. I feel it is noteworthy that there was not a single malfunction through any of those rounds while we had the rifle. The internals are extremely robust and have features like dual extractors and other things that aid in reliability. The Spear is remarkably reliable, and that is of course great to see out of a military rifle. The handguard itself has plenty of M-Lock mounting surfaces for whatever accessory you'd like to add, along with a QD sling attachment. I think it is important to note that SIG has added two screws to attach the handguard to the upper, along with the dovetail and the front takedown pin like the MCX has always had. There have been reports of the old MCX handguard having issues holding zeros when using laser aiming devices, and this would appear to be a solution for that. I want to talk about the barrel for a second. In an earlier video, I said that I was concerned about barrel life, and when you're running rounds that produce 80,000 PSI and run 2,900 feet per second out of a 13-inch barrel, because this gun, as it will be equipped for the military, will have a 13-inch barrel, normally barrel life should be a concern. However, I learned that all the SIG 277 Fury barrels are made out of a special, extraordinarily strong steel called Mar Aging Steel. Not even sure I'm pronouncing that right. But I'm not going to pretend I'm a metallurgist, but you can look it up. This steel is extraordinarily strong and should greatly extend the barrel life of these guns. It is, however, rather expensive, and that contributes to the cost of these rifles and probably the upcoming SIG Cross barrels that will be chambered in 277 Fury as well. The upper features both a side charging handle and a more traditional rear charging handle like an AR-15. The way SIG has done this is ingenious, simple, and far less complicated than you would think. I will go over how they achieve that in a separate disassembly video, and in that video we'll go over all the internals. Also important to note that the charging handle does not reciprocate while being fired. The lower has a lot going on: full ambidextrous controls, mag release, and bolt hold open. The lever on the right side of the rifle will hold the bolt open when you push it up and release the bolt when you push it down. Very cool and sleek design. Grip is nice. I like the profile of the SIG grip, and it would appear to be compatible with any AR-15 grip, so if you don't care for it, you should be able to customize it as you like. The trigger is very mil-spec-like. It's not great, but it's also not bad either. It has the slightest amount of take-up, and it breaks at right about 5 pounds. The hinge for the stock has also been slightly improved with the original MCX design. It now features a push button and is far easier to operate than the old design. It would really just seem that everything is very well refined in this version of the MCX. I've been a fan of these rifles for years, and I actually own a Gen 1 version and a SIG Rattler. I have always felt that they were very good, but something was always just kind of missing, like the gun was 9/10 complete. The spear feels like the MCX design is finally complete, and all the I's have been dotted and all the T's have been crossed. This is a very nice and very complete rifle. I know that one of the big concerns when people learn about this rifle and this cartridge is the recoil. I would like to say that the recoil is actually very tame for what it is. Now, what exactly do I mean by that? Well, of course it has more recoil than a 5.56 rifle, but it is a much larger and more powerful cartridge. However, I would say that I feel it is actually less recoil than 308, even when you load up the hotter 6.8x51 into the gun. I would say that recoil is pretty close to that of 6.5 Creedmoor, which is a little less than 308, but obviously more than 5.56. You do also notice a little more recoil when you switch from 277 Fury up to the 6.8x51, but not as much as you would think. All in all, I would say that for the majority of shooters, the recoil will be very manageable and less significant than what some other people on the interwebs have been claiming. But no doubt about it, it does kick more than a 5.56, but most rounds do. We tested the MCX spear at ranges out to 1,000 yards, and it performed extremely well with both the commercial 277 Fury and the hotter 6.8x51. Making these shots was actually extremely easy, and this rifle is more than capable at those distances. We did test the groups at 100 yards too, and they wouldn't be what most people would call great. But a couple things to keep in mind: this particular SIG spear gets around like a Ferris wheel. This is the gun that Grand Thumb used in his video, Forgotten Weapons and Administrative Results. Also, this gun is used by Illumined Arms, the owner of the gun, as a demo gun in full auto. All that being said, a newer spear might be slightly more accurate, and we had no problems making hits on any man-sized target at any distance we tried out to 1,000 yards. And while that group might not be exceptional for a precision rifle, it is actually pretty darn good for a military-style rifle. But what was just as impressive is how maneuverable and manageable it was going through a competition stage, somewhat simulating a CQB scenario. This rifle is more manageable than it looks. The reasonable recoil combined with the weight made it surprisingly easy to maneuver. The SIG spear in 277 Fury isn't as compact as an M4, but it's not overly large either. It actually feels very maneuverable to me and the others who got to shoot it. We tested its ability by running competition stages with it, and everyone who shot it felt it was more manageable, more maneuverable, and lighter than they had thought. While I wouldn't exactly call this rifle light, it weighs in at 8.68 pounds, I wouldn't call it overly heavy either. But what I found extremely interesting is we weighed an HK MR556 as well, the civilian version of the HK416 or the Marines M27, and it weighed in at 8.92 pounds, both bare rifles. So that actually gives the spear a slight weight advantage over what the Marines are currently using. I have to be completely honest. When I read the press releases about what the Army was going with, I was shocked and thought they had made a huge mistake. I felt that there were far better options available, and going with a completely new caliber and weapon system was near lunacy. After getting to spend some trigger time with the SIG MCX Spear and 277 Fury, I have become a believer, and I do feel like this is an excellent weapon system for our troops. Now, I do feel like it may require a little more training time to capitalize on all of its capabilities, but these are things that can be worked through. But really, I'm just a guy who lives in the woods with way too many guns. So what does my opinion really matter anyway? And that's why I decided to ask one of the guys who I go shooting with, Hunter, who is a Marine and spent some time in Afghanistan, how he felt about the SIG Spear in 277 Fury.
That's huge because, you know, when you're in the rounds start flying, you don't really have time, nor are you thinking about, oh, you know, let me adjust my scope or...
And that will be the next video in the series. Hear the thoughts of an actual warfighter and see what he thinks of this new weapon system and if he feels it was a huge mistake or a move in the right direction. It's a pretty interesting discussion and I feel a valuable perspective, so I hope you'll check it out when it goes live. For everyone enjoying the series, along with the video I just outlined, I will also have a disassembly video on the internals of the SIG Spear and a video on the suppressors that we used with the Spear and the SIG clutch system. Because of the changing rules on YouTube, those videos will be exclusive to Patreon and Utreon subscribers, so if you want to see even more, you can go there to get it. Guys, thank you so much for watching, and a huge thank you goes out to Illumined Arms for making this all happen. They were the ones that loaned me the 277 Fury Spear so we could get all this data for you. If you're not subscribed to the channel, go ahead and hit that subscribe button right now because we have some more videos in the 277 Fury Spear series. We also have some other really cool stuff in the works that you won't want to miss. So go ahead and hit that subscribe button and the notification bell so YouTube can let you know when we drop a new video. If you want to see what's being reviewed in real time, way before it hits the YouTube channel, check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Also, if you like what you see here and you want to help support the channel, the best possible way to do that is through Patreon. YouTube's been making some changes here, and we will be putting more videos on more topics on our Patreon page, so go subscribe to that so you can get a deeper dive into everything that we do here. And as always, guys, thank you so much for watching.